Good evening, everyone. So now we are waiting for people to join. So we have about 580 participants who registered. So we're waiting for at least a majority of them to join in. So in the meantime, please stay with us and please do not use chat because we don't want to overload the system. Thank you.
Webcam is correct.
Correct. You could introduce yourself. Say at the end of it, we will cut this. Alas, we can't share with all of you.
Good evening, everyone. So now we are ready to start our webinar. So this is the 60th birthday of Laser. So we'll cut this cake after. So we're sorry that like we cannot share it with all of you, but hope you'll all enjoy the wonderful talks which will follow soon. So before we start, like, so I would like to thank two people especially. One is Professor Vivek Polshetiver, who provided us this Zoom webinar link, which we're able to use and reach out to so many people. And the second one is Mr. Rajesh Mistry of the auditorium staff, who has been here to set up all the things, right? So thanks to them. And we'll start now with Professor Ravindra Kumar's talk, who will introduce us to the wonderful, glorious years of Laser over the past 60 years.
Is that final?
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure for us to have you all this evening. On behalf of my colleagues here who are joining this webinar, and on behalf of everyone at TIFR, it's a great pleasure to have you here for the celebration of the 60th birthday of the Laser. And as you already have seen this, most of you must have seen this, there are six speakers. I'm Ravindra Kumar. I'm going to tell you the past 60 years of the Laser, and my colleagues who follow will showcase the achievements and also predict what's going to happen in the future. Of course, with some personal glimpses of our own, as we are all users of the Lasers in different domains, and we hope to convey some of that excitement to you today. So I have called this the Lasers history. Is nothing but scintillating, spectacular at 60. From what was called somewhat derisively as a solution looking for a problem. It's turned the situation totally around. Now it's a solution for almost all problems. And I'm sure you'll agree as we go along. And it's facilitated some fantastic discoveries in science. It's facilitated absolute cutting edge technology and very futuristic breakthroughs in technology. And of course, it has adorned itself justifiably with lots and lots of Nobel Prizes that are listed here. And I'm going to pick the ones that I've listed here. I will elaborate a little more as I go along. And my colleagues will provide sufficient proof that all these things have been realized and much more is going to happen in the near future. So it's a privilege to have the greatest scientist of all times, Albert Einstein, who proposed this idea. So it's great that he is associated with the laser as well, not just the theories of relativity and the photoelectric effect. And he proposed in 1917 that there is an atom in the excited state can come down not just spontaneously, but also by what is called stimulated emission. And the stimulated emission is, of course, at the core of the laser principle. So typically, these atoms are all in a cavity surrounded by, which is sort of bounded by two mirrors. And the stimulated emission is fed back again and again. And a little bit of that stimulated emission from the cavity leaks out in the form of the very nice laser beams that we all use. And this slide tells you, on the right hand side, you have the first laser, the model of the first laser that was made in 1960. And on the left, you see the explosive growth of photons inside the cavity. And if I might say, this is something that we've been talking in the last 2 months about, the exponential growth of the virus. So the laser exemplifies that in extreme style. So this is also growth which is explosive once what is called the threshold has been breached inside the laser. And the laser has, all of us know that it's monochromatic, it's extremely bright source, it's a coherent source which has facilitated various applications like holography and so on. And not only that, the laser has been a model system to study extremely interesting problems in physics, in what is known as also synergetics or synergistics, if you like it, which are all based on cooperative behavior in physical systems. And it's also been a very nice test bed for studying things like instabilities, chaos, phase transitions, and providing analogs of very beautiful quantum phenomena like superconductivity and so on. So these are the pioneers of the laser, who I have just shown them in one frame. Theodore Maiman, who made the laser. And on the right-hand side, you have Nikolai Basov, Alexander Prokhorov, Charles Townes, who actually proposed some of the early concepts, and Gordon Gould, who also played a very interesting part in the development on the birth of the laser. So the major scientific breakthroughs from a personal point of view, my colleagues will illustrate many more. For myself, I'll pick three of them. The first one is the Bose-Einstein condensate, which was realized in the late 90s at Gila, Colorado. And I would call this actually the coolest achievement. And I'm sure you all understand why I say this. It's the coolest achievement, producing an extremely special quantum state called the Bose-Einstein condensate state. And it's a privilege that we have our own Satyendranath Bose, who's associated with this principle of Bose-Einstein condensation. And incidentally, this is also the coldest, perhaps the coldest place in the universe, right? It's the temperatures there are nanokelvin. And what's so special about this quantum state is that from a disparate state of, molecules and a gas, which are all in different states, below this, when you make this transition to the Bose-Einstein condensate, they all collapse into a macroscopic coherent state, which is what is called the Bose-Einstein condensate. And justifiably, it received the Nobel Prize in 2001. For the three pioneers who made this happen in the lab. And the second one is, of course, proving quantum mechanics right. Some of you might find this very surprising that, we take quantum mechanics for granted these days. We have lots of quantum things, quantum computers and everything happening in our, at least the proposals being made right now. And, but actually quantum mechanics is something that's very hard for people to understand. And it took a long time for most people to establish that the world is indeed quantum mechanical. And one of the crucial tests of proving quantum mechanics right was done on what is called a Bell's inequalities experiment. This was done in Paris by Alain Aspect and his colleagues. And this actually provided the first proof of the correctness or the applicability of quantum mechanics for all physical systems. It also led us to absorb or sort of internalize notions like non-locality and entanglement. And these are all specialized concepts, but these are extremely crucial concepts for the future of quantum systems as we go along. And so they are driving quantum computers, quantum information processing, quantum cryptography, and whatnot. And the second one that I that I picked up is on gravitational waves. The third one, sorry, is on the gravitational waves. And all of you know that we had this path-breaking, earth-shaking discovery, if I might say, which was unveiled a few years ago. And this is being made possible because of the crucial role played by the laser in the gravitational wave interferometer called the LIGO. That's in the US. And the cosmic waves, the gravitational waves that are unleashed by the merger of two black holes, in an extremely violent fashion, have been captured in the ripples in space-time, which are captured by this gravitational wave interferometer sitting on the Earth. So now we have many, many more discoveries of these gravitational waves, and it's led to a new window into the universe called the gravitational wave astronomy. And the laser has played an extremely crucial part in this interferometer. On the left-hand side, you see the interferometer spreading over many kilometers, the two arms of the interferometer in the US. And three people who made this, the three pioneers, got the Nobel Prize justifiably in 2017. And I would also like to say something very interesting, that when you look at the laser, that it is the pinnacle of achievement in both the frequency domain and the time domain. Normally people talk of doing experiments in the frequency domain or in the time domain, but you pick either domain, and then you have the purest light that's been made possible, has been made possible by the lasers. And these are all extremely narrow, pure, highly monochromatic light, which I call as, you know, the purest form of light that man has known. And these have enabled extremely precise measurements in the lab of very important quantities in physics, fundamental constants. They provide the basis for some of the best clocks that we have. And they also power precision technologies, which will become obvious in the next hour or so. And if you come to the time domain, which is, you know, the complete contrast, the shortest burst of energy unmatched by any other methodology. And I repeat that, unmatched by any other methodology or device are found in lasers. And these range from, you know, you can go down all the way till the attosecond, which is 10 to the minus 18 seconds. So the routine lasers that we have at TIFR and elsewhere, many of these laser systems are femtosecond duration. And if you push the, if you do some experiments with that, that actually can push you into the attosecond region. Justifiably, anything that is as fast as attoseconds or femtoseconds will give you a snapshot of events that are happening inside matter on those timescales. So now people have watched molecules dance, walls, if you will, and ions vibrate in a crystal, or even electrons tunnel out of an atom that has been excited by a laser. So all these things have been caught in real time by the fastness or by the rapidity with which the laser can evolve in time. And of course, many technologies have also been powered by in the fact that you can have such ultra short pulses. And this slide shows you that lasers everywhere, as all of us know. So there are lots of pictures here which capture the ubiquitous role that lasers play in our modern lives. I don't need to go through all the lists, but you can just sort of look at them in rapid succession, and I'm sure you'll all agree that these are all very, very important things. In fact, we take it for granted that lasers do all this now. But let me show you again from a sort of a more technical point of view, the two spectacular achievements that the laser has made. One is, of course, the laser space communications. So we all know communications on the Earth. We also know that we send things into space with which we need to stay in touch. And we also want to use space-placed objects placed in space for communicating with each other or one another on the Earth. And we also want to send things which are going far from the Earth, and we want to keep track of what they're doing, how well they're doing, and so on. All these things are made possible by lasers. And on the right-hand side, bottom of the slide, I'll show you a picture where a laser beam just goes into a medium and produces a spectacular display of colors, a whole range of colors. So one color laser beam nearly one color laser beam, producing an array of colors which span a huge amount of spectral range, right? And so this is a phenomenon, beautiful phenomenon called supercontinuum generation. And you can also push, use a laser to go all the way till the X-rays on at one end, and you can also come down to the terahertz region at the other end, at the soft photon end. And all this progress was made possible by a suggestion made by Maria Goppard Mayer, who in 1931 made a proposal of what is called the nonlinear optics. And the nonlinear optics means light behaves, light drives matter to behave nonlinearly, and hence generating new frequencies, new processes, and so on. So this is, it's very nice to acknowledge the crucial role played by this lady scientist in as early as 1931, about 30 years before lasers were actually invented in the lab. And this tells you that lasers are everywhere. They're in eye surgery. They're in fusion targets. On the left-hand side top, you can see that the laser fusion capsule, which is created by lots and lots of lasers. Hopefully, man will realize fusion in the near future, and we will all move into safer energy regimes where we don't have pollution and other problems. And on the, if you look at the bottom, the right bottom, then you'll find that this is the optical fiber technology, which is enabling all kinds of communications and internet and, you know, all sorts of things that we do on communications is these days rooted through fibers. And eye surgery is just one aspect of the surgeries that have been made possible by lasers. And at the center, I have this blurb which says the laser displays some kind of a dual personality. It can heat, it can cool as well. It can expand, it can squeeze, it can cut, it can fuse, it can push, or it can trap. So this is one thing where it can do anything it likes. And that is what is truly, truly exciting about the laser. And who doesn't love laser shows? And I'm sure you've been to, some of you have been to one of these, where you're drenched in spectacular shows of laser beams coming, you know, routed through various mirrors. People are dancing on the floor, and the whole spectacle is something that you can never forget once you've been there. And we also love them in the movies, right? So we know that all the guns that they show in the movies and so on are all, you know, laser beams which are sort of shooting across. And just to say that these days, lasers have also encompassed a huge range of physical sizes. For example, in the palm of your hand, you can hold a million lasers, as one of my colleagues will show you in a short while. But you also have lasers which occupy something like 2 football fields. So this is one of the most powerful lasers in the world at the National Ignition Facility, which is driving some of our efforts on realizing fusion for generating power for mankind. And this is a spectacular, a gigantic laser with 192 laser beams producing a whopping energy of 1.8 million joules. And the first laser produced nothing but a very, very small fraction of the energy that we are talking of, maybe a billionth of this energy or even smaller. So this is the range over which the lasers have progressed in the last 60 years. And I'm sure the next 60 will see a dramatic leap in all sorts of parameters that the lasers encompass these days. And to go back with some personal touch, I'd like to say that the birth of the laser itself was a very turbulent story. And it's a very interesting example of the sociology of science. On the left-hand side, you have Theodore Memmen, who actually made the laser happen. So he is the inventor. And on the right-hand side, you have three physicists, Prokhorov, Basov, and Charles Townes, who actually won the Nobel Prize. They only made the proposal for the maser, and they realized the maser, but they only made the proposal for the laser, but they truly never realized the laser. And if you see at the bottom on the left, you have Gordon Gould, who actually won the patent for the laser. So the guy who made the money from the laser is Gordon Gould. The guy who made the laser is Theodore Memmen. And the guys who got the Nobel Prize are Townes, Prokhorov, and Basov. And incidentally, Townes writes in his autobiography that he got the idea of the laser on a park bench. So in honor of that idea being discovered on a park bench, you have this statue of Townes sitting on a park bench in a park in the US. So it's been a great pleasure for me to open this session and to thank you for all this, for the time that you have given for this webinar. And we wish the laser another sensational 60 years and beyond. And now I invite my colleague, Sudeep Tumaiti, for the next story of the evolution of the laser in the last 60 years. Thank you. This is the next slide.
Hi guys, Sudipta here. It's a real pleasure to talk to you in these COVID times through Zoom. But to tell you the truth, I hear that about 600 people is listening to me here. I don't remember a conference where 600 people sat around to listen to me. So I think it shows up opportunities. So lasers have lit up literally, 60 years ago, that little light that emerged from Ted Maiman's laser lit up his room. But in 60 years, it has lit up the lives of pretty much everybody in the world in many different ways, in communications, in other ways that Ravi, my colleague, talked about. It has also really made science progress. And one of the areas that it really helped progress in is cell biology. Much of the cell biology that you know today has been possible by use of the laser in microscopy. That's a little bit I'll tell you about. But let's step back. Let's step back to an optics experiment that everybody has done when he or she was a child, which is taking a magnifying glass and burning a leaf. So I used to have a lot of fun with it. The one that I could get the magnifying glass from the market, it took a while, and then my dad got me a magnifying glass from Bangalore. Bangalore, for some reason, had great magnifying glasses. And I could see that that burned the thing much quicker. Okay, it caught fire much quicker. So the quality of the lens, the size of the lens, and the quality of the lens matters, because it's easy to see why. Because you can make the smaller spot with a better lens. Okay, and this is sunlight. And I tried that with that Bangalore lens I was very proud of. I showed around to my friends and all. And I tried burning a leaf from a light bulb. Okay, no matter how close I was, how far I was, how bright that light bulb was, in wedding ceremonies, you have these 500 watt bulbs and all. I could never really focus it down to start a fire in a dried leaf. And I wonder why. No wonder, because the light that comes out of an extended bulb is incoherent. It's very difficult to focus down to a small spot. It needs to be collimated. That's one of the properties, one of the many properties of the laser which has changed the world. It is collimated. Sunlight does well because sun is, though an incoherent source, an extended source, is very, very, very far away. So collimation means parallel beams. And so the sun beams, the sunlight comes in a beam which is nearly parallel. So that's why it does so well. But there is nothing like a laser in collimation. So at the bottom, I'm showing some green light, and it focuses absolutely to the smallest possible thing for a lens. Okay, so this is not just the power of the laser, which is, of course, can be very high, and it's also used in biology, but it's also the property, the collimation property of the laser, that helps it go down to the finest point that is possible. Question is, how fine is that point? Well, that point is actually not a point. When I was a child, I thought if you have this absolutely collimated beam, then you get a real point. There is something called diffraction, and diffraction limits it, visible light focus, no matter how good a lens you have, to about 200 nanometers. That's the smallest that you can achieve. But that's good enough, because a human cell is about 50 times larger than that 200 nanometers. So people soon realize that you can go into a human cell and focus point by point in different parts of the cell to make up a 3D map of that. And the way to do it, the mechanics of it, actually was invented about 7 years before the laser was invented by Marvin Minsky in 1953. But this, it requires a pinhole, etc. It's called a confocal microscope. It couldn't be realized before the lasers became mainstream. So it really became commercial in the 80s. And then a revolution happened in cell biology, where we started getting pictures, clearer pictures than anybody had ever been able to do. And so I'll show you some examples. This is some cells, okay? You see multicolor because you have to paint the cells with some kind of a fluorescent color. So the nucleus in blue, the membrane of the cell in red, and the green on the top left you read on the side, yes, it is the human coronavirus. Okay, you can see in the green, it's entering the cells. Of course, it's not the COV2 that has been around for the last 6 months. It is 2018 paper. It's a cousin of that, OC43, but it's very similar. And right now, I'm sure in many labs, these kinds of experiments are showing exactly how a virus attacks the cell. So that's very good. But what is the most interesting thing to do with the microscopy? There are two things. One is about breaking this diffraction barrier to 200 nanometers and using the same principle that Bose and Einstein proposed, which is stimulated emission, which makes laser possible. Somebody came along, about 70 years after they had proposed it and suggested, look, that same thing can be used to sort of prepare a beam of darkness. So imagine a spot 200 nanometers and you have a donut-shaped beam of darkness which takes away the energy by stimulated emission from the periphery of that spot, leaving the inner 10 or 20 nanometers. So now instead of on the left side of this image, you see a normal confocal microscope 10 years ago, and the right side you see, and that's 200 nanometers or so resolution, the right side you see what is possible now with stimulated emission dumping microscopy. One of the Nobel Prizes that Ravi showed 2014 was awarded to Stefan Hell for this. The final challenge, the thing where I land, is ultimately to understand the brain. Okay, this is, on one side, you have the universe, that LIGO and the black holes colliding. The other side, one of the most complex things is us. Okay, a human being with a brain trying to comprehend the universe of which it is the creation of. Okay, so yes. So the first thing is that the brain needs to be lit up in different colors, and people have come up with many different ways to do it. 2008 Nobel Prize for GFP, green fluorescent protein, was for that. And nowadays you can light up different cells of the brain, as you can see in this picture, with many different colors, 80 different colors in this. And with a laser microscope, as a confocal microscope, you can hear, or you can see the neurons talking to each other. They talk through tiny bursts of chemicals known as neurotransmitters, but they also light up with calcium and other things that you can look at. So my personal experience or my personal interest has been really to understand the brain, but what would make me the happiest? Well, is to understand what makes me happy. No, not really. I mean, really. What makes me happy and what makes you happy are really one of these two molecules. One is serotonin, one is dopamine. There is a family, there are two or three more, but these are the two main molecules that make you happy. Every time you're feeling happy, you know, sipping your coffee or, saying hello to a friend over the phone, anything that makes you happy, ultimately these are the transmitter molecules that go from one neuron to another. And the challenge for me when I was growing up academically was to make sure that we can see these molecules. These molecules have a problem. The normal painting of proteins do not work because these molecules are very small. You cannot hang a large protein to it and expect it to work. So we had to take a different approach. And the laser made that possible. Okay? Laser made that possible by doing something which is called multi-photon microscopy. So these little molecules can absorb in the UV. The same problem that that you have, the UV light, if you shine on, let's say, the coronavirus is dead. Unfortunately, UV light, you shine on a neuron, the neuron is dead. So you have to do what the UV light does, but without using UV light. So there is a way that this lady, Maria Goeppert-Mayer, who is the basically creator of the field of nonlinear optics, suggested that there's a tiny effect. If you can bunch up all the photons together in a short pulse, you get tiny probability that two red photons can add up their energy to give you the equivalent energy of a blue photon. And that's what was actually taken by this gentleman sitting standing here, Watt Webb at Cornell University, to come up with something which is called multi-photon microscopy. Use red light, do blue microscopy. Use red light, do UV microscopy. That's something I did later. And it's fortunate you can see me much younger with a lot more hair in this side of the. So I'll show you and here some of the things we have been in our pursuit of happiness, what we have seen. What you see on the left side are actually dopamine molecules packed in little balls. They're called vesicles. The whole scale of the picture from the top to the bottom is about 30 microns. Those vesicles are of about of 50 to 100 nanometers. We see them resolved only to about 200 nanometers, but you can actually see them. You can actually see the happiness molecules. Look in the middle what happens. You know, human beings are too smart for their own good. They have figured out that if you have those things called drugs of abuse, if you use them, then the brain gets short-circuited, the happiness molecules are released, you don't have to do anything for your happiness, you feel happy. And that's exactly what he wanted to understand. On the top, you see molecules, the neurons which he culture on a plate. In the bottom, the same neurons, they have released all their happiness molecules with a drop of something called amphetamine. Amphetamine is a drug of abuse, actually. So this is what we have been working on, trying to understand what gives us happiness, really. So I leave it at that, and all this has been possible. Our understanding of the brain in many other ways has been possible because of the laser. Okay, so I end with this, that the father of the nation was a curious soul, and you can see here, see him here looking, peering through the microscope. And, you know, he was obviously more interested in liberating us from the yokes of the British and all that. But this is a simple microscope. Who knows, if you had a laser microscope, where his attention would have been? So I thank my people, lab people, who have actually let me do all this work, and thank you very much for this. And I guess the next talk is, okay, by M. Krishnamurti, who is sitting in Hyderabad, and we'll give this.
I have to stop sharing so that I can share.
MK, will you please share your screen?
Yeah, you have to stop the sharing. Yeah, can you stop the share? Gopal, can you stop the sharing? Gopal, you have to stop the sharing.
I can't see the screen.
You have to stop the sharing, Gopal. Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead. Yes, MK.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Krishnamurti. I am speaking actually from Hyderabad at the moment, but I'm work both in TFR Mumbai and Hyderabad. So I'm going to take the next 10 minutes to try and tell you what the world was missing without the high intensity lasers, and what are we doing with the high intensity lasers in recent times. So all of you have seen the sun that wakes up every day, but if you take a good picture of the sun, this is how it looks, and the surface temperature of the sun is about 6,000 degrees, but if you can go deep into the core of the sun, you will find that the temperature is close to 15.7 million degrees. Not only that, the temperature is very high, the density is almost 20-30 times more than what more than steel. So you are having a nature of matter which is extremely hot, at the same time extremely dense. We know very little about how the physics, the laws of physics work in this regime. Is there a way that we can make such a system, even if it is qualitatively, of course qualitatively, and repeatedly test how the laws of physics in this system? So I come with three of these kind of challenges. The second is, if you take a massive planet like Jupiter, at the core of the Jupiter, because of the heavy mass that is there, the hydrogen actually goes into a new form. It is beyond what you would call as a metallic form. So it is under what is supposedly something like 80 megabar pressure. Can we do a lab experiment where we can sample such a material and test again the laws of physics under such conditions? The second challenge. A third thing leads me to tell a little bit about accelerators in modern science. Everything that we know today about atoms, about the microscopics of how things are happening, is by the accelerator. Electrons were discovered. We know that the nucleus is made of protons and neutrons, and we know that even protons are made of something called quarks. All this was made with accelerators. Accelerators are a very, very important part of modern science. So what is an accelerator? You have two plates kept under some voltage. You have a charged particle that flies from negative to positive, and depending on the voltage, So if I put a 3 volts battery across 3 meters, I get 3 electron volt particles. If I want to do that at a million volts volts or million electron volts, I have to put a million volt battery. And this has been very, very useful. And all over the world, people have built very, very enormous amount of, spend enormous amount of money to build big accelerators. Because the crux of it is the technology or the science has remained exactly what I told you with the two plates. If you, the maximum voltage you can put is 100 megavolts in a meter. So if you want a very, very high energy, you will have to put longer acceleration columns. For example, what I saw on the left side is Indus 2 accelerator at Indore. We have spent crores of money with hundreds of scientists building 172 meter long accelerator to generate 2.5 GeV electrons. On the right hand side is a Stanford linear accelerator. It's actually also a laser where the electrons are accelerated on a 3.2 kilometer long column to get up to 50 GeV. And all these are used to generate new kinds of light. And that's why they're called synchrotrons. And as I said, the Stanford one is actually even a laser because the light is made like a laser. If you want even higher energy, for example, if you want a tera electron volt, if the scientific principles remains the same, the only thing we can do is build bigger and bigger acceleration column. With 100 megavolt per meter, again, if you want a TeV, you need to put kilometers long. And the Large Hadron Collider, many of you would know, is 27 kilometer long, built by spending $10 billion over hundred countries and 10,000 countries. So the challenge that I pose, or we have posed in science, is can we make an accelerator of such kind or such quality in a lab that fits in a small space? This is like, for example, we are in a small lab where one student can sit and manage this machine. The answer to all these three questions is intense ultrashot lasers. So obviously this has to be something special. When you say intense, how intense? You're talking about putting a whopping million megawatts of power in 1 square centimeter. Obviously we don't want to run out of the world power. So we borrow this power for a very, very short time. And that is for a billionth of a millionth of a second. So in something like a 10 femtoseconds, we can pack in joules of energy, focus it down to a square centimeter and get these energies. And so the energies that we're talking about is in terms of intensity. The intensity is energy per unit area per unit time. And as Sudipta has said, the lasers have this tremendous ability to be able to focus in a very, very small areas. And if you have make ultra short pulse, like what Ravi said, the femtosecond pulses, then you can actually immediately see from this equation that you can get 10 to the 15, 10 to the 17 watts per centimeter square. But if you want to do this same 10 to the 15 watt per centimeter square without a laser, for example, if you want a 10 to the 12 to 10 to the 15 watts per centimeter square, you would have to hold a lens that is as big as the earth and focus all the sunlight onto the tip of a pencil. Obviously that's not possible, and the lasers give us this tremendous ability to do this. And this has been such a revolutionary thing that in 2018, the technology, the people who made this technology for these intense lasers have been given a Nobel Prize. And it's nice to know that Donna Strickland is one of the few women in physics who have received a Nobel Prize in the modern world. And this is Gerard Morrow at TFR Lab visiting us. So how does, let me take some of these examples. The thing I told you that we are taking these challenges and we're able to do it. If you look at a laser light, laser is made of light. Light is an electromagnetic wave, which means it has electric field that is oscillating and a magnetic field that is also oscillating with it. Now, when I say very high intensity, the electric field is very, very large because intensity is proportional to E square. So when I put enormous amount of intensities, I'm talking about enormous amount of electric field. Now imagine to make it into a laser, we also need to talk about something called plasma. A plasma is nothing but a soup of electrons and ions. It's like water in a sea. Normally it is quiet, but if you have any disturbance, and you know here the disturbance itself is temperature, just like the water molecules move, here the electrons move. And when the electrons move, they form into bunches. And if you take a snapshot of this wave, you will see that electrons are all coiled up in or bunched up in one particular space. and there is electron depreciation in other space. So if you take this as a high potential or a field, you'll see that where the electrons are, the potential is very negative. Where the electrons are depleted, the potential is positive. And this electric field difference can actually accelerate things. But normally, these electrons move back and forth, the average field is zero and nothing happens. But when you shoot something like a very, very intense laser into this kind of pulse, this void can be made to last for tens of picoseconds. And the amount of electrons that are moved is so large, or quite large, that instantly, in across 10 microns, you can get close to a 5,000 megavolt potential. So this is enormously large than what you can get if you didn't have a laser at all. As I told you, 100 megavolt per meter, and now we are talking about 100 times larger than that, close to. So, and how does the laser accelerate particles? This is just like you have a wave. If you have a boat, now instead of going by oscillating wave, if you follow the boat, and if you're a clever surfer, you will be always at the slope so that you will get continuous acceleration from the trough that is created by the boat. And a laser does very, very similar thing. The laser plows through these electrons, and there are electrons that are trapped in this field, and they follow the light. Since light travels at the speed of light, these trapped electrons also travel at the speed of light. So intense lasers with plasmas can actually accelerate particles. So if you do the correct things correct amount of light, ultra-short pulse, correct conditions, you can actually convert most of the laser light energy into an electron beam. And here is an example where, the latest, if you see today, you have 5 GeV electrons produced close to in a millimeter in petawatt, using a petawatt laser in Berkeley. This was a result about a year ago. So basically what we have done is shrunk a 100 meter accelerator into a millimeter. And so, you all have seen this. So we can get qualitatively similar as a big 100 meter accelerator down in a millimeter. We can also do exotic things, accelerate not only new electrons and ions, but you can also accelerate neutral atoms. This is one of the discoveries of TIFR. Now, the second aspect I told you about apart from acceleration is to make a sun-like situation in the lab. And this is a picture of the National Ignition Facility laser that Ravi was showing. Here, what you do is you take a 500 micron bubble or a balloon of hydrogen and tritium, and you put in 190 lasers. And just like the way you have your thumping material with your hand, here the laser thumps the matter and compresses it down with a very, very, into a very, very small volume of very, very high density. And that can ignite because of the high temperature that can ignite, that can be inside. So not only in big laser facilities, you can also do it on a tabletop. This is an experiment that was done in TIFR and was a highlight, a paper published in PNAS that was a highlight all worldwide, where you can see qualitatively very, very similar thing that happens in a sun, in a magnetic turbulence in the sun. So theoretically, you can create very, very similar features and understand the rules of physics. This is one other experiment where you have a drop of a liquid falling, and you can see the sun kind of conditions being made. Here, the temperature is close to a million Kelvin, 10 to the 10 Kelvin. So from a drop of a liquid with an intense laser under the correct conditions, you can actually produce 10 to the 10 Kelvin temperature, if not the density. And this can be done with a very, very small laser. So you can use this kind of lasers, plasmas, just like the way the sun is a source of light, X-rays, and everything. Here, our sun is also a source of electrons, X-rays, and positive ions. You can do imaging with it. You can do radiography with it. You can do other things with it. So it is actually a virtual accelerator. And we can do, of course, the challenge is not over. We want to do make this more efficient. We want them to be able to handle much, much fundamental problems. So we can handle problems related to astrophysics, accelerator, hot dense matter, because the density can also be made very, very high. The pressure can be made very high. The magnetic field can be made very, very high. And in future, there is, of course, futuristic projection about even being able to do particle physics in these conditions. And of course, we are setting up such facilities coming up soon in TFR Hyderabad. And if you want to know more, this is our website. You can check it out and write to us. And thank you very much. These are the pictures of the two lasers, one of the most powerful lasers in the country with which we are doing experiments today. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Is that okay? Okay. You can ask.
You share the screen.
MK, can you hear?
Yeah, I can hear.
Then you share something with the number.
I stopped sharing.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Gopal. I am Jyotish Pan, and I am a chemist at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And it's just a wonderful opportunity for all of us to get together and talk about lasers and what they have meant to us. As chemists, we are always thinking of new ways, new creative ways of making molecules in the lab. But at the heart of chemistry, really, is just this idea that one can selectively break a bond or make a bond. However, the problem lies in the fact that when you do that, when you try to do that, you cannot watch the bond because the bond, the chemical bond, the length scale of a chemical bond is close to an angstrom, a few angstroms. So how does one go about doing chemistry in the lab without watching these bonds? Well, traditionally, people have used chemical intuition to make molecules, but lasers have made a major difference in the last 60 years. And they have really impacted the way we can actually watch a bond breaking or a making process. With the invention of Theodor Maiman's remarkable invention almost 60 years back, chemists have been able to use lasers in varieties of forms. The color of the laser allows for chemists to excite the molecules at different parts of its absorption spectrum and, trigger photochemistry. The brightness can be made use to make reactions go faster. You can also use the rapidity of excitation of coming from a laser, especially the pulse sources, to actually trigger reactions at a very fast time scale, very precisely. Apart from that, as Shudipto, one of our colleagues, mentioned just before in his talk, the collimation and the directionality of the laser can really enable us exquisite spatial control on chemistry. And this can be thought of as not only just for imaging purposes, but also for photodynamic therapy, where you would like to therapeutically intervene the growth of a tumor, for example. But what was most surprising in all of these, in all of these impactful things that came out due to the advent of laser was a very, very surprising discovery that as coherent the laser source is, sometimes reactions can be coherent. In fact, I will demonstrate this in this talk today, that sometimes the phase in which the atoms move in a chemical reaction really leads to the selectivity of the products that are formed. And to enunciate that, I'll just talk about and describe how the eye, the human eye, or the mammalian eye actually sees and perceives the universe. And this comes from the fact that all of us have this protein molecule called rhodopsin. And the entire chemistry of vision lies at the heart of this protein molecule, which is nothing but a retinal molecule buried inside the protein coat. If you actually just look deeper into this, light absorption sort of makes this retinal molecule go from its cis configuration across the C11-C12 double bond to its trans configuration. And once it does that, the protein molecule actually readjusts its conformation and tells the rod cells within our eye that we indeed have seen a light, a photon coming in. And this simple chemistry, the isomerization chemistry, is not new to the chemist. The cis-trans isomerization chemistry has been there for a long time. And all the founders of chemistry, like Professor G.N. Lewis at UC Berkeley, had been studying this for a long time. What is interesting in this paper that came out in 1940, G.N. Lewis, in fact, made a prediction. It was one of these predictions that could revolutionize the way we think about forming chemical bonds or breaking chemical bonds. The prediction came in the fact that when he was working with a molecule called cis-stilbene, and he was using sunlight to irradiate cis-stilbene, he found that the emission from this molecule was abysmal. It actually was in the order of 10 to the power minus 3 in quantum yield. It told immediately Professor Lewis and G.N. Lewis that, in fact, the time scale perhaps for this chemical reaction to proceed to the transform should be in the order of 10 femtoseconds by a simple-minded calculation of radiative rates. And that really set the framework for chemical reactions, that all chemical reactions should at the limit, should work at the limit of a vibrational period or the vibrational time scale. With advent of lasers, it turned out that chemists had to wait slightly a bit to sort of figure this out experimentally in the lab. But very quick, rapid progress in ensuring that you can lock in the phases of a coherent laser source allowed for generation of pulses through a very specific process called mode locking, which is actually seen all across different kinds of different kinds of electromagnetic radiation sources. You can make these lasers lock into a phase and generate pulses. Not only that, almost 20 years from that discovery, from this particular work by Pierre Reeve and Hargrove, Chuck Shank at UC Berkeley came up with this idea that you can make pulses of a duration close to the vibrational time scales by compression, by very nice grating-based compressor. And these pulses could be as low as up to 30 femtoseconds. This was in 1982, okay? Just keep this progression in mind. Then came the wonderful work of Donna Strickland and Gerard Maru, which Professor M. Krishnamurti in the last talk described. And people came to know how to amplify pulses through Chuck pulse amplification. And once this happened, bright pulses were ready for a chemist to use in their labs to do very, very specific chemical reactions. And that's how, in 1985, Ahmed Zavel, working in his Caltech lab, just starting out as a professor in Caltech, devised a method by which he could look at bond dissociation through excitation of molecules in the excited state. And this was in 1985. Ahmed Zavel's famous paper in 1985 in the Journal of Physical Chemistry demonstrated the power of these pulsed laser sources, that you can excite the molecules to its excited state, in this case ICN, and then let the molecules trickle down the potential energy surface. And while they are doing that, watch the molecules evolve in time with a probe pulse. And these two pulses were optical laser pulses. These were femtosecond pulses. You excite by 280 nanometers in the deep UV, and then you watch it with any color of light that would allow for an absorption event to take place on the fragments that you generate, either the iodine or the, you know, the SCN molecule. Going back to the story of how a human eye detects light, since G.N. Lewis had already given us the idea that isomerization can take place in tens of femtoseconds, Chet Chang and Rich Matthies really made 10 femtosecond laser pulses in their lab in 1987 and started doing experiments on rhodopsin. And rhodopsin being a classic case of isomerization, cis-trans isomerization, they expected to see very fast chemistry in the excited state. In fact, if you can see in this slide, I've shown very clearly the potential energy surfaces of the ground state of the molecule in its cis form, then being pushed up to the excited state by a femtosecond pulse, close to 10 femtoseconds, and then you can probe these changes on the excited state as the molecule goes down and traverses the excited state potential. You can watch how the energy gap changes with time, and that's exactly what was probed in the transient spectra, all the way from 33 femtoseconds, 100 femtoseconds. These snapshots provided the absorption spectrum of this particular molecule as it was evolving to its trans photoproduct. It was clearly blue shifting as expected for the potential energy surfaces and was done within 200 of femtoseconds. So G.N. Lewis was not too off. He was only 20 times off, but it was clear that vibrations, there are critical vibrations that actually drive this process. So while doing this experiment, by 1994, there were sufficiently experts in producing these data again and again, looking at this data, but they started observing very interesting oscillatory features in their absorption spectra decay profiles. And these oscillatory features told us that in fact, vibrational modes were in sync while they progress towards the photoproduct. And a simple mathematical analysis of the beating patterns led to the Fourier transformation of this spectra and the generation of modes, the vibrational modes that contributed to the photoproduct formation. It turns out it's almost 23 years later or 24 years later from that science paper in 1994 when they reported vibrationally coherent isomerization in retinal, it was even more clear how in-phase combinations of torsion along the C11-C12 double bond with the hydrogen movement, the hydrogen out of plane motion, the hoop mode, actually led to the chemistry. And if they were not in phase, and if they were out of phase, all those molecules would return back to the ground state cis configuration. This made a deep impact in our understanding of how chemistry happens even within our eye. Well, is the coherence limited to just isomerization reaction? No, that's not true. In fact, our lab recently demonstrated that you can break bonds. In fact, you can do hydrogen atom abstraction reactions, which are hard to do at the time scales of, you know, up to a picosecond, like 900 femtoseconds, which clearly tells us that you can do chemistry at a very fast time scale if you know how to put them in an, you know, in a protein-like environment in a confined space. And you can get selectivity with light-induced processes. The future that comes is very bright because we think that with the discovery of coherences in chemistry, it's not just limited to watching the interesting molecules in biology, but also you can start doing synthesis in the lab by actually judiciously choosing your reactors. And this can be done by watching reactions as they are done in your test tube by applying laser technologies. One laser in the optical regime to excite the molecule, the other laser in the X-ray regime to actually watch how the structure is evolving because you can collect diffraction patterns. Well, with that, I just wanted to conclude. We in TIFR do very similar things in terms of looking at time evolving structure, but we use a discovery made in India, which is Raman spectroscopy in the time domain to look at how structure is changing with time in very complex systems that do isomerization, charge transfer, and other kinds of very interesting chemistry. With that, I would like to conclude and thank all people who organized this particular session, and also my group members who make everything possible for me to be presented here. So, and if you have any questions or comments, you can of course email me or you can visit our website. With that, I would like to conclude and invite Professor Prabhu to talk about some of the very interesting aspects of lasers and materials.
Thank you. So thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here. And I wish to thank my previous speakers as well as Professor Gopal for I'll be talking about materials, lasers in material science. And I already, the laser is so incredible, and it was already known as soon as it was invented. And a lot of these different magazines started speculating about the use of lasers, their designs, etc. And that irritated Professor Arthur Shallow, one of the co-inventors of lasers, so much that he put all these different articles on his laboratory door and said to people that really, if you want to see the credible lasers, please come inside and see. Because the size of these lasers and everything was so huge and the powers were so less that he was really irritated with their thing. This was, of course, 60 years back, and now things have changed quite a bit. There are all types of lasers, with the solid, liquid, gas, all types of lasers have been made. And after me, Professor Arnab will also tell you about semiconductor lasers. And people have developed all these different lasers. They have studied different materials and they have found certain suitable materials, and they have used those to again develop additional different types of lasers. So this progress has been going on at a tremendous pace. And these lasers have been used for different types of research in materials, for cutting, drilling, micro machining, welding, engraving. And the most important thing has been in the data processing, communication, ink film development, lithography processing. And finally, I will also speak a little bit about its time resolved phenomena, where this has been used pretty heavily to study materials. Although I cannot cover everything, I will give you very slight snippets of this. The main problem with the laser as soon as it was invented was its size. And Professor C.K. Patel, he actually invented the CO2 laser, which is very heavily used in material processing. And you can see that big laser has been miniaturized such that you can now cut steel, you can print different parts in wood, you can drill holes in stainless steel, you can also do micro machining and create beautiful periodic patterns. And in Surat, like places in India, people have been using this for diamond cutting. And these are the green lasers that are used quite heavily in the diamond industry. You can also use these lasers for welding or also writing down different patterns, 3D patterns inside glass or transparent materials like plastic or even fabric. And you can also do different kinds of engraving and all this. So there have been large amount of applications of these high power lasers. The main issue is, how does one really do this drilling? Because if you use, there are different processes which actually occur as soon as you put a laser on the material. So the best idea is to not destroy all around it and get very pristine and clean kind of holes. So that's the reason people started using picosecond or femtosecond lasers, because in a short time, this laser bullet actually evaporates the material, and there is not enough time for the shock waves to penetrate through, and everything is happening in a very short time and all the material is ablated out. While if you use a very broad pulse laser, it actually transfers the shock and actually destroys the material. So you can see, with just picosecond type of lasers or even a shorter pulse laser, you can get very beautiful and very pristine, clean holes which are being drilled here. And these have been used for drilling holes in very thin materials, plastic materials. And these have been used very heavily to record certain patterns, and on the and you can actually see in this portion that depending on different kind of spots, the different kind of lasers that you have, you can focus them into a small spot also for writing as well as for reading. and therefore you will see 780 nanometer if you use the spot size is bigger. If you go to 650 nanometer, the spot size becomes even smaller. And in the same area, you can have much more patterns that can be accommodated. And if you go to 405 nanometer, which is blue, you can have much more pattern which can be accommodated and can be read by this laser. And this is the basic reason behind CD, DVD, and Blu-ray. And on the right side, I already shown you the ACM picture of this. And you can see in a small region, you can put in large amount of data very easily. Now, what happens is when the photons, the laser photons actually hit the material, there are a lot of interactions which happen. The first femtosecond region, the interaction is extremely fast, and slowly this gets passed on to the material over several picoseconds, and over nanoseconds it becomes much more equilibrated and all that, and therefore the crystal starts responding to it. So the best idea is to quickly, using a short laser, ablate this material. You can also create shock waves, and these shock waves for different times, you can create different kinds of patterns. So for example, if you put this energy directly on the material, you can directly transfer it from solid to the gas region, and this way you can move the material from one portion to the other and transport it and deposit it on another substrate. And these kinds of things happen even in your usual life. This is sand dunes formation, because these kind of shock waves can give you very beautiful periodic patterns. And also the higher power can actually ablate this material. You can transport it, put it on different substrates, and you can, varying the conditions, you can make different kinds of nano patterns. And these kinds of nano patterns have been studied and have been made by Professor Gopal, who is one of the organizers of these coordinators. And you can see he has made very beautiful periodic patterns of these on different substrates, and it actually modifies, changes bands. So basically what happens when you put the light over these, the light that gets transmitted completely changes its properties. So you can make materials which did not exist naturally. You can actually artificially create them and do this. And this is just possible with the help of lasers. There are other advantages also of these lasers, that you can pass this light through different crystals, and red light can get converted into blue, or can be converted into IR. So different kinds of things one can have applications of. And already Professor G. Ravindra Kumar and Professor M.K. and others, they have already mentioned with the very high power laser sources, if they pass it through the crystal, you can see you can generate right from red to violet, all kinds of colors which are seen here in this photograph. And these can be used for what this is called white light continuum, and you can use it for studying different kinds of properties of material. There are different types of spectroscopy which this has given rise to study this material. And now we are getting into the physics aspect of this. And this is a very, very dense subject, but I will tell you in a very simple way, that you put an incident light on this sample, then you can either look at reflected, transmitted light, or whatever that gets emitted out from this sample. So accordingly, you will have absorption, transmission, reflection, or fluorescence spectroscopy. And on the left side, you can see this light getting illuminated with blue laser is already giving you different kinds of colors other than blue. Now, you can also do these studies using time-resolved phenomena. And for this, you need different types of pulses. So if your pulse is very short in time, it will contain large amount of other energies or other frequencies. But if your pulse is very broad, then you can have very single frequency. So this way you can decide your time resolution or frequency resolution or the energy resolution to study a given phenomena. Because what happens is when you excite the beam, we call it a pump beam, whatever emission that takes place, it comes at different times. So you can see different colors coming at different times. But to know what color is coming at what time, you need another light, which is called the probe beam. And this reflected probe beam or transmitted probe beam, you can have a look at and its evolution, and that will give you a large amount of information. So that way you can look at the transmission, reflection, again, fluorescence spectroscopy. And this way you can generate, suppose you take a cadmium selenide like crystals, you can study different polaritons, excitons and different kinds of things and how they evolve as a function of time. Or you can have these different Coulomb vibrations of these crystals and you can see there are different modes. So whatever reflected light that comes in, it gets actually modulated and you can see this, it is getting modulated as a function of time. And if you take the Fourier transform of this, you will find that it is actually showing you different modes, which are the phononic or magnonic modes. And this happens because the reflected light actually gets coupled to this phononic mode and it starts showing these kinds of very wonderful things one can do. So this, there are multiple such applications. I mean, then there is, one can continue doing this quite a lot. So these lasers have already become part of our daily life. You've already seen this using, all of you have used semiconductor lasers for pointers. Many of you are using it in health bands, and this is a green laser. And how this happens, this is bringing in another revolution, that bringing them to your pocket will be taken over by Professor Arnab Bhattacharya, who will be taking you along the journey of how semiconductor lasers have revolutionized our life, and they continue to do so. So I look forward to Professor Arnab to take you on the further journey. Thank you.
Hello and good evening and welcome to the last part. I get to wrap this up talking about semiconductor lasers. While we celebrate 60 years of the first laser, the key things that have helped semiconductor lasers be widespread happened about 50 years ago, and let's see what the historical developments were. So firstly, we are going to go from big, really big. On the left, you saw these massive petawatt class lasers. On the right, you see these very, very tiny, there's an ant, and below it is an array of lasers. Each of those dots is one semiconductor laser. These are the smallest lasers in the world. And the most common laser is a semiconductor laser. And they are everywhere. They're everywhere, from your barcode scanners to pointers to laser printers. If you're watching this talk on the net, it's because there's a laser providing the ones and zeros somewhere, there's a blips of light. They're used in medicine, materials, as you just heard. And in the last 50 years, amazing progress has been made. Now, in any laser, you need to be able to put in energy, get a population inversion, and have a cavity for the laser to operate. And semiconductors are ideal for this. Firstly, if you look at a simple PN junction, if you forward bias a junction, there are excess electrons on one side and excess holes on the other. Having a lot of electrons and no electrons, which are holes at a lower, your lower energy level has less electrons. So you have more carriers at a higher state. This gives you the population inversion. This is a very simplified picture of it. Also, most semiconductors have a refractive index of about 3.5. So you don't even need additional mirrors. Just the material contrast with air is sufficient to get lasing. And it's very easy to get a huge amount of gain. So these lasers are really tiny, tiny, that you can, don't need large gas tubes, just a millimeter of gain medium is sufficient. Now, while the idea of a stimulated emission in semiconductors was there in 1953 by von Neumann, it was in 1962 that four groups reported laser operation at, of course, liquid nitrogen temperatures. Now, what is really interesting is that all these papers, these four papers, November to December 1962, they don't use the word laser in the title. They call it coherent light emission from gallium arsenide or stimulated emission from gallium arsenide. The word laser was not popular at that time. And they are all either in applied physics letters or in PRL. And these are either based on gallium arsenide or gallium arsenide phosphide materials and at very low temperatures. Now, the key idea that happens to really boost the performance of lasers is the idea of taking different materials together and making sandwiches or making heterostructures. And this is by Herb Kromer, who said that, look, if you have only a single material, if you put an electric field, electrons and holes will always move in opposite, they'll feel opposite forces on it. On the other hand, if you can change the material, you can independently control the forces on electrons and holes. And the key idea was a double heterostructure laser. And this was the idea of making a sandwich, taking something with a low band gap
and sandwiching it between materials of higher band gap, so the carriers would get confined in this little low band gap material. And this idea from 1963 was actually rejected by Applied Physics Letters, the same guys who published the first papers. But of course, Cromer got the Nobel Prize in 2000, so I guess it's okay. Now, this was an idea. To make it required new growth techniques. And this happened in 1970. Two groups, first in Russia at the IOF Institute by Alfarov, who's on the rightmost lower part of the picture, and his team, they created the first room temperature operating CW diode laser. Very soon after this, at Bell Labs, Hayashi and Panish, they also demonstrated a laser, and both these groups used gallium arsenide and aluminum gallium arsenide using a growth technique called liquid phase epitaxy, where they could grow layers of about 0.1 micron in thickness. Now, the double heterostructure is so important that I'd like to spend 2 minutes telling you why it is so good. But before that, let's see what happened. In 1970, another very key breakthrough for our world today happened, which was the development of low-loss optical fiber. And this enabled fiber optic communication because you had low-loss fiber and a tiny diode laser which could turn on and off to give you ones and zeros. And very soon after that, the first transatlantic cable, fiber optic cable, was laid, TAT-8. And that had, you know, only 296 megabits per second. That sounds so small these days. But that was more than the capacity of all the copper wire cables that existed till then. And the more important thing, a year after this cable was laid, a tiny experiment happened that connected CERN to Cornell University, and the web was born, the World Wide Web, and the rest is history. Today, of course, you have commercial fiber optic systems that can operate at speeds of 65 terabits per second over transcontinental lengths of 6,000 kilometers plus, and in the lab, people have demonstrated more than 10 petabits per second. And remember, all this is from a tiny laser. So the double heterostructure, let's come back to it. The idea is you're making a sandwich, high band gap outside, low band gap inside. Now, this obviously is good because the carriers like to fall into the low band gap region. Electrons are lazy. They want to go to the lowest energy state. Holes are like bubbles. They bubble up to the higher thing for the valence band. But the beautiful thing is this sandwich also has a refractive index, which is higher in the middle. And this automatically gives you a waveguide and makes the photon density higher and makes it easier to get lasing. And this is why the double heterostructure was key to making room temperature operating lasers. Now, obviously, why don't we make this region smaller? Everybody thought of that. And as they made it smaller, why not make it as thin as possible? And while doing this, they realized that if they made it really thin is less than about, 100 angstroms or so, new effects came in due to quantum confinement. And today, most of the lasers are what are called separate confinement heterostructures. You decouple the light and the electrons. The light is confined by a waveguide, which can be a micron. The electrons are in this very, very small thing, which is about 50 angstroms or so, which are then called quantum wells. And these quantum wells offer many, many, many advantages over normal lasers in terms of being able to get you much higher gain in order to change the wavelength and use materials which you otherwise couldn't if you had to grow thick layers. Okay, so thanks to the use of quantum wells, the threshold current started coming down. Remember, the right-hand axis is a log scale, and while we move from quantum wells to quantum dots, etc. I'm going to look at this tiny laser. Remember, the advantage of it is really, really small. How small is it? It's just about a millimeter in size, and maybe 100 microns or by 500 microns. 500 microns simply because we need to hold it. Now, I have a box of lasers with me. I can't see the screen, so somebody will have to tell me if you can see it. Hopefully, are you following this? Can you see this? Just check this, if it's visible.
Yeah, I can see.
Yeah, so hopefully in this box, if you see some glinting specks, those little specks, little dots, those are lasers which we make in the lab. So these are the tiny, tiny, tiny semiconductor lasers that drive our world today. They're very efficient sources of light, almost converting more than 50% of the light into electricity into light, and operating at very low voltages as well. Okay, so now I'm just going to look at one example of high power lasers. This is an area where I had worked in. Again, an enormous amount of research has happened over the last 30 years. At one time, when I was a student, 8 watts from a 100 micron stripe was considered wow. This is like 15 megawatts per centimeter squared. And the reason I show this is a tribute to Garbuzov. Garbuzov was part of Alfarov's team who got the first laser. And it was a privilege to have worked with him in the past. And this was 8 watts from a 100 micron stripe, which meant if you want to combine these lasers and make what are these bars, the typical bars with 20 or 30 lasers of them, which you see on the right of your screen, you would get maybe about, you know, you wouldn't want to operate them at the limit, you'd operate them at 3 watts each, you'd probably get 30 to 40 watts from a bar. Today, these 1 centimeter bars put out not 30 to 40 watts, but now the power scale, if you read the axis, it's in kilowatts. You can get 1 kilowatt from a 1 centimeter long bar. And then remember, you can couple these bars into stacks and get even higher powers. So multi-kilowatt diode laser modules are now available. This is mostly in the IR region with gallium arsenide. The other component which was very important was the blue laser. The blue laser was invented only around the year 2000, and it got the Nobel Prize in 2014 for Akasaki, Amano, and Nakamura. And initially, as you heard in the earlier talk, it was Blu-ray discs that, and data storage that was driving this. For smaller wavelengths, you could focus it down tighter, but these require only milliwatts of power. Recently, there have been huge developments in this area, and now you can get kilowatt class operation from even blue lasers. There's a recent result from Laserline in Germany, 2 kilowatts from coupled stacks of blue gallium nitride based lasers. So lasers, semiconductor lasers have had fascinating impact in many, many areas, from vertical cavity lasers, quantum cascade lasers, tunable lasers. You can get 128 different wavelengths from a laser in a very controlled manner. And this is all thanks to combination of new device concepts, new materials, and the ability to grow them with atomic level precision, and the ability to make devices, you know, new technologies able to make gratings, etc., to make devices, has led to this revolution in lasers. And the future for diode lasers and semiconductor lasers and all lasers is certainly extremely bright. So thank you very much for listening.
Hello. Yes, so that concludes our presentation. So if you have any questions, like, please send on the Q&A window. So there are many of these questions which are already answered. So a couple of them which we can pick up for answering. Or for example, like one question which came out. Which magnetic field?
That we will answer.
Yeah, but maybe just for the public, like, so. Yeah.
Okay, so how do we?
Yep, you can sit.
Okay, so I believe there was a question on the role of the magnetic field of the intense laser wave. It's already been answered, but let me say it again, that normally at low intensities of light, the magnetic field is extremely small, so we don't bother about the interaction of that with matter. But at high intensities, you have the magnetic field is significant. It can actually change the trajectory of the particles inside the plasma. And there can be additional heating mechanisms that can come up, acceleration mechanisms that can come up, and so on. But this is somewhat specialized. So if you could send us a mail, I will provide the relevant material for further exploration, and we can discuss it further.
So Arnav, so why was creating a blue laser a big deal?
Okay, I was typing out the reply to that, but okay, why was creating a blue laser such a big deal? Well, many semiconductors existed with band gaps in the visible red region till the IR region. To go to the blue, you need something like gallium nitride or zinc sulfide or zinc selenide. Now, zinc selenide, these compounds were not very stable. They used to work for an hour, 10 hours, but the materials would die. You didn't have any reliable material. Gallium nitride was the first material that became reliable, but to grow high quality gallium nitride took researchers almost 30 years. And that was the key reason for Akasaki and Amano to get the Nobel Prize was they could figure out how to grow high quality gallium nitride. Once you could do it, then you could make lasers about it. It's still quite amazing because this material has almost 10 to the 9 defects per centimeter squared. These defects would ideally kill the luminescence, but the material still works very beautifully. Of course, for a laser, you need it much nicer. They did a lot of work to reduce it, but still it's about 10 to the 5 defects per centimeter squared. It's an amazing material, gallium nitride.
Okay, go on, next.
Yep. Sudipto. How do you identify it as a dopamine molecule and differentiate from other molecules using laser?
I'll be happy and see what comes out, but that's a joke. So every molecule has its own spectra. So what you do is the light that comes out, the fluorescence, you actually put it on a spectrometer and see what is the spectrum that it has. And then you normally know, so you compare with that. If you need further things, you also do the excitation spectrum. That is, where does that molecule excite? With these two combinations, there's a very small chance there will be a mistake. But the initial experiments that we had to do, we had to work with things called antibodies to prove to everybody that these are the indeed the molecules that we had. Okay?
Okay. So the next question is about how a pump probe experiment actually works.
Yeah, thank you for the question, Mahesh. The pump probe idea works on the fact that you take two laser beams. The first laser beam is actually the beam that excites the molecule to its excited state to start a reactive process. And the second beam, and it could be narrow band in excitation, the second beam needs to be a broadband sort of a pulse, depending on where you are working in your laser regime, your laser wavelengths. But that beam is going to collect normal spectra. That means an absorption spectra or some kind of a spectra that can record that tells that the molecule is in the excited state, has a slightly different color as compared to the ground state. Once that is done, you can do an on-off sequence. You can switch off the excitation pulse and just have the probing beam. So you can distinguish it from the ground state configuration of the molecule versus the excited state. And as the molecule evolves in the excited state, based on the delay between the two femtosecond pulses, you can watch the molecule at different points in the potential energy surface. Hope that clarifies. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so the next question is about nonlinear crystals, like how red light is converted to blue light.
Okay, very nice question. Basically, what happens is the laser has an enormous amount of intensity. So normal experiments that you do when you pass on the light through normal material, that electric field of that light is does not create any additional kind of polarizations. But what happens is when your intensities are very, very high, you will start seeing additional terms which are higher order terms that those go as E square, E cube, E raised to 4 like this. And then if you see that each of these electric fields are actually oscillating with certain frequencies, say omega, then you have E square means it will start getting added to it. So it will become omega plus omega, that is 2 omega. So if you are having 800 nanometers as a red light wavelength, then it will get doubled. In the frequency means it will become half in wavelength. So 800 nanometer will become 400 nanometer. So you will have red light going in, but the blue light coming out.
I might just like to add a few things to what my colleague Prabhu said just now. All of us understand if we have done some basic physics that light in the visible region basically interacts with the electrons inside matter. Right? And one of the most famous models of physics that we have is the simple harmonic oscillator. So for low intensities of light, the model that we use for excitation is that the electrons and the nuclei that holds them, so the electrons move around like linear harmonic oscillators, so small extension away from their main positions. But as the electric field of the light increases, the electron experiences a stronger tug, and hence the motion becomes nonlinear or unharmonic. Unharmonic in the sense it deviates from linearity. The standard harmonic potential gets distorted, it becomes nonlinear or it becomes unharmonic. And once something is driven into unharmonicity, the higher order behavior shows up. And this you can also experience. For example, many of you may have seen from audio amplifiers that if you really increase the gain enormously, you have distortion, and the distortion is mainly because of the nonlinearity or the harmonics of the frequencies that you want to hear. And the harmonics will make the sound look, it will totally distort the sound and you don't really want to hear it. So unless, and people spend a great deal maintaining the purity of sound in audio amplifiers while, increasing the bandwidth so that you can get, and that's the reason for all the costs that you pay. So the simple reason is that if you drive a system, any physical system, weakly, you can live with your linear approximation or the simple harmonic approximation. But if you drive, if you tug any system very strongly, then the behavior becomes more complicated, but certainly much, much more interesting.
Okay, there are quite a few questions on, like, can laser be used to address the COVID? Like, somebody wants to, like, for specific detection.
Well, actually, the COVID is a problem only when it's in your body. It's easy to kill if it's outside your body. So you don't really need a laser. A simple UV light will kill the coronavirus, not the COVID. COVID is the disease. So it's tough to see how you can shine light inside the body without killing your own cells and killing the virus. The way the laser will help is by actually solving the scientific questions, you know, by following it with microscopy, by doing other things, and by making us understand how the coronavirus is affecting us. That's how laser will help. For just killing the coronavirus, UV light, you know, something like this, this is a sanitizer, this will be enough. But that's outside the body. Inside the body is a very different form.
Yeah, there's one more question for you. How do you identify? Okay, you already answered this. How do you identify it as a dopamine?
I think this is a good last question. Is the development of laser sigmoid saturated? Do we know everything? What we can expect? That's the last question.
Well, as we move towards the next 60, as I said, laser technology is going to grow by leaps and bounds. There'll be improvements in every parameter, as we hope. And most importantly, there is this new generation, new kind of lasers which are emerging, which will be the trendsetters for the future. Of course, at the moment, they are very fancy, big machines. These are called X-ray free electron lasers. And these have, they are going to revolutionize every field that you can think of, from biology, physics, chemistry, because these are extremely powerful pulses, not in the visible region, but in the X-ray region. So you're going to very hard photons, but you're producing huge fluxes of these hard photons. And imagine what you can do. So you can, we've been talking about nonlinear optics with visible beams. You can do nonlinear optics with X-ray beams. And that would mean dramatic discoveries in the way we, in fact, in the last few years that the X-ray free electron lasers have been working, we've already created new phases of matter, and we are just flooded with data, in particularly in biology, where we are seeing structures at such high precision and such high resolution that it will take us huge amount of efforts just to understand what these data are telling us. Okay, I would also like to point out, as my colleague reminds me here, that currently we are building, the world is building extremely powerful lasers, which will take the power levels to something like 10 petawatts and beyond. And these are supposed to drive physics at, you know, nuclear physics with lasers. They are supposed to produce high energy particle physics with lasers. And they're supposed to do whatever you can think of, you know, at the extremely high power levels. So these are three pillars in Europe. It's called the Extreme Light Infrastructure. It's called the ILAI project. And the fourth pillar is still to be decided, but this is a multi $100 million European project, which is shaping up at in Romania, one pillar, in Hungary, another pillar, and in Czech Republic, in Prague, another pillar. So the three pillars are already ready to go anytime now and you know, start producing results. But as all of us who are laser enthusiasts believe, that what we have seen is very little, and the real action will begin now. You ain't seen nothing yet. Thank you.
Okay, with that promising words for the future, let's conclude this session. So on behalf of all of you, like, I would like to thank today's six speakers, and on your behalf,
like I would also like on our behalf from the TIFR family, we would like to thank all of you for your active participation and making this a success. Thank you very much.
So we'd like to thank all of you. Each one of us wants to come and say goodbye to you. So please stay on for a little longer.
Okay, so thank you very much for your enthusiasm. And from our behalf, we'll actually have to thank our own friend, Achanta Venugopal, who has really taken his time to organize all of this. So thank you very much. Very happy to be here.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much for coming here and for with all your enthusiasm, and I hope you will all have nice lazy action going on. Thank you.
Okay, it was wonderful talking to all of you, although I couldn't hear you back directly through your audio, but thanks for the questions. And if you have more questions, then there is actually a TIFR run child-wise site on Facebook. It has been advertised there as well by Professor Arnab Bhattacharya. So you can add more questions to the comment section in that advertisement. Thank you very much. And stay safe.
Yeah, hi. This is Arnab. Let me just amplify this first thing. Thank you all for listening to this. Today's event, if you go to the Facebook page of Chai and Why, Chaiandwhy, go to the event page in the discussion section. If there's something which you'd like to ask, type in your question. We'll try and get an answer as quickly as we can. Thank you very much.